Watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Statehouse program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Well, good morning. Welcome to the Democratic press conference for the week. We welcome everybody online and here in the room with us today. We only have a week of session left after this week, and so we have a lot to do yet. I want to give a little update from Senate State Affairs. Yesterday, we passed out House Bill 1076, which creates the Government Accountability Board. Representative Karin Soli is the prime on that from our caucus on the House side, and Senator Brock Greenfield is the prime on the Senate side. Just want to give Representative Soli some due credit on an issue that we as Democrats have been working on for a long time, to create essentially an ethics commission of sorts that covers the executive branch. It's made up of, going to be made up of four ex-judges and no more than two from one political party. I think that's really important in the discussion, to make sure that it's bipartisan, but these individuals also come from a unique position that they were not partisan in their prior service. And so we're really looking forward to getting that on the Senate floor and hopefully passage of that. Another bill that is important to note that actually failed was House Bill 1130, which was going to create a process by which folks that brought initiated measures would have to come in front of the executive board of the legislature. And so that died on the House or the Senate floor yesterday. And so we were happy to see that go. We did pass a bill to have a summer study or task force on the initiated measure process, and that will now go to the, well, we'll have to get concurrence on that from the House side because we did change the makeup of that. I brought an amendment to ensure that there was more representation from the minority party and or independents, because the way that was set up, 13 of the 15 members could have been from one political party, and that to me is pretty problematic to a pretty high degree. And so the final thing that I'll say from Senate State Affairs yesterday was a frustration with SCR 15 that was the targeting refugees resolution. We spent 2 hours debating or hearing testimony on that resolution, an hour from each side yesterday morning, and then we forced people to come here and testify on a resolution that carries no weight of law, and they wait all day. We come back in the afternoon, and rather than dispatch of something that was so disparaging to a group of people that are fleeing their country for safety and freedom to save their lives, they bring an amendment that guts the whole thing rather than tabling the resolution and moving on with our day, that has three whereases in it congratulating our president for giving a speech in DC. And it was incredibly disrespectful to the people that came there to testify in opposition, especially on something that affects them so deeply. And even though it does not carry the force of law, I was incredibly disappointed with the process, and incredibly disappointed that we would waste everyone's time on something that I think Senator Heinert said best: it could have been in a thank you note. We do not need to be dealing with these types of resolutions at the last hours of our legislative session when we haven't even passed a budget yet, and we have so many big issues to deal with. So with that, I will turn it over to Representative Spence Hawley, and I'll stand by for questions.
Thank you, Billy. Well, it's great to see 1076 pass yesterday over in the Senate side. As we've talked about repeatedly here with the repeal of IM-22, we had kind of three issues that we wanted to see happen. The first was the government accountability, 1076, and this one is really for the setting up an ethics commission for the executive branch side, and it's geared at the aimed at the gear up EB-5, those types of discussions. The next step is 1073, the lobbyist limitations, and I believe you haven't taken that up yet, but hopefully that can get through. We passed that out of the House. And then the last one was SB 54, the campaign finance reform, the hoghouse bill of the Secretary of State's. That has come out of the Senate. We've had that in State Affairs in the House, and we'll have that on the floor next week sometime. One of our biggest concerns is that has been watered down. And we've got to make a decision on and if we're going to support it in its form it is now or not. It does add some limits. It doesn't add anywhere near the limits that IM-22 did. So I guess that's the discussion factor going forward. Is there still enough substance there that we want to support it? I can't give you that answer yet from our side. I know on the Senate side they did oppose it. So we've yet to make that discussion. It's kind of an interesting session towards the end here. You know, we had three bills, I think it was, got on consent calendar yesterday in the State Affairs. We have one contentious bill, it'll be on the floor today, it was the 149, and that was changing for adoption agencies to allow them that if they do a discrimination, that we would allow that, which right now they can discriminate against the LGBT community and all that if they don't want to allow adoption. And that's fine, because that's their decision. My problem with the 149 is that they're saying that they should be eligible for programs also from state dollars. And that's where I have a problem. If you want to take it to that next step, I'm not supportive of that at all. Nurse midwife has been another discussion ever since I've been in, well, since we came into session. We've had a nurse midwife bill every year, allowing in South Dakota. We had that on the floor yesterday, and as you know, that passed. There's been a lot of discussion over the years and a lot of takes. The medical community still does not support it. The nurses did not oppose it this year, and the doctors, AMA, did oppose it. But it looks like they've got a lot of the areas that we've had disagreements on in the past worked out this year, and they will set up a certification board, and we'll see where it goes from there. There is a need for it, and I'm hoping we got the correct controls on it now. The other discussion, 2018-2017 budget, I would assume that right at the beginning of the week we'll probably finish up with the 2017 budget, and the decisions are being made in appropriations now, which Senator Sutton's on, and then move on to the 2018 budget. Obviously, there will be no growth for anybody. I'm hoping we maintain the 3/10 inflation growth for the K-12. That's our expectations that we have that, and definitely no cuts in those areas, as we've said before. So, unless you got anything else you want to add, Billy, want to open up for questions?
Yeah, I think it would. The one thing that I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about a little bit is, across the nation, what's going on this week is called the Week of Action, especially for working families and the working class. And I just wanted to bring attention to that because we brought our opportunity agenda this legislative session. All those bills died vastly on party line votes. And I think it's important that, especially as we move into the next legislative session, that we, as a legislature, and not on party line, that we start looking to address how we help the working class get ahead and the working poor, because these are the folks that drive our economy day in and day out, and we would really like to find some common ground and support for several of the measures that we brought, including pre-K education and paid sick and maternity leave, and more support for needs-based scholarships. So many things that I think are really important to South Dakotans, but we got sidetracked from that with worrying about repealing IM-22 and the discussions about how to replace that, when we really needed to be talking about how we help the working class get ahead. And so I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that that's going on across the nation right now. So with that, we'd stand by for questions.
Can you tell me a little bit more about, you know, the budgeting process as we're getting closer to that deadline? I know there's been a lot of talk, you know, like about no increases this year, but I guess how's it shaping up and what can you tell us?
Yeah, I'll give you my perspective. I think there's a very real potential that there's going to be no increases across the board, which is incredibly disappointing, especially when we're seeing a crisis for our community support providers. We have incredibly poor reimbursement rates for many other Medicaid providers. We expect our teacher pay and to keep increasing, yet if we hold a 0% increase, that's going to be very difficult for schools to give increases in teacher pay. But yet in a couple years here, we're actually probably next year, we're going to be monitoring whether they're meeting their targets. And I'm going to remind everyone here in the legislature that if we do break state law, which is 3% or CPI, whichever is less, so at the very minimum, we're required to give a 0.3% increase. But as we all know, with enough votes, you can do anything. And the legislature on a couple occasions has voted to change state law to zero or even cuts for education in the past. My first year here in the legislature, we cut education 8.6%, which was by us changing the law. So I'm going to be very disappointed if we don't give at least the 0.3 increase, which is in statute. But it's a very real possibility that that doesn't happen based on the makeup of this legislature. I think there are ways that we could get creative, especially with the money that we gave to property tax relief last year, about $36 million. We're taking part of that back for the ADRDL lab. We could do the same for education and our high need healthcare providers, because there'd still be $31 million of increased sales tax that went to property tax relief. So you could look to shift that, but as we haven't set the education budget yet. And to your question, you asked about the process. We have subcommittees that are giving proposals to the full committee to set each department and agency's budget. Just met this morning with some folks to discuss the education piece of that. And so those discussions are ongoing, but it looks like we're gonna try to adopt that budget or that portion of the budget next week. And so nothing is decided yet, but our hope is to at least give the 0.3 and to try to do something for high need providers, especially community support providers.
Continuing on with the appropriation and the budget process, Speaker Mickelson told me earlier this week that the real battle in the last 8-9 days is $25 million from the 2018 budget, that it's a big pull, but it all comes down to finding $25 million in 2018. Can you tell me a little bit about your thoughts on that? Is that number high? Is it low? And what's the likelihood that it will come down to that?
The process, you know, when they set the revenue projections, is that we have the governor's BFM, Bureau of Finance Management, gives their projections, and then we have the LRC, Legislative Research Council, gives what their projections were, and they kind of then try to figure out where the revenues are going to be. Usually the BFM comes in lower with their projections. This year they used a 4% growth rate on sales tax, and the LRC's model was only using a 2% growth rate. So so they took a lower number than the governor actually was proposing from the BFM. So there could be a discussion of was that a correct number or not, if you wanted to raise the revenues a little bit. I mean, that's part of the discussion. As far as finding $28 million, the finding's going to be in the cutting. You know, what the governor proposed is not going to happen, and which areas are not going to happen would be the real question right now. The 1% that we've talked about, just from everybody's discussion, I don't know how that will happen.
And to give you my take on it, I think if you want to talk about it, he said $25 million, that what we were short from after adopting revenues was $27 million. But you have to remember that the governor proposed about $19 million in increased spending for K-12 providers and for state employees. So if you were to ratchet that 1% increase back to zero, then you're essentially short $8 million. So you have $27 million that you're short, but 19 of that was already proposed. So if you took away the 1% that the governor proposed, you would really be short $8 million. So that's why I'd say it's not likely for those groups to get 1%. But how can we get to 0.3% and still find cuts elsewhere to make up for that 8 million shortage and then the cost of that 0.3% increase? If that makes sense and answers your question.
Then a little bit of follow up on that. Do you see the diagnostic lab in SDSU? Is that going to make it into the final round when we're here a week from now? Will that be in the final budget, or what's your
thinking? Well, I'm totally optimistic that the animal disease research and diagnostic lab at SDSU will be in. The big issue was the funding, as we discussed before. The governor's proposal was fees in the ag economy. The pushback said from the ag economy says we can't pay increased fees when we have reduced incomes coming in. So the proposal came up that we use the refund from the property tax on the ag land, a percent of that, from 5 to 7.5 million, and set that aside in an ag research fund, and then out of that ag research fund they would take the roughly $3.5 million for bonding for the ADR deal. And the ag community across the board that I've heard out here seems supportive of it. So based on that, I'm really, really hopeful that it continues through and stays in.
Well, and I would just add on, I think it is really important, but I think the takeaway from this is also to remember, and for the public to also remember, that where there's a will, there's a way. And so we see that the majority is going to be willing to find this ongoing funding stream for the ADRDL lab. So we could also find funding for K-12 and for our high need providers. I mean, if we really wanted to go down that road, because those property tax relief dollars are still available. I mean, we could do the same thing that they're doing with the ADRDL lab and come up with that money. So let's not forget that if the majority really wanted to give an increase to education and to providers, they could.
I asked, you guys were talking last week about possibly dipping into reserves if you had to. I asked the governor's office about that as well, and they said that there was like no appetite really to dip into that because those reserves sort of keep South Dakota's credit rating at AAA. Is there still that, you know, how might the budgeting process look without dipping into reserves?
Well, in all honesty, from our standpoint, we say the reserves should be on the table. The problem we've had since I've been here 7 years, that's never on the table. The only thing that's ever on the table is adding to the reserve account, not taking out. And it's a difference in philosophies, period. I think, as we've discussed, that the reserves are rainy days or glitches in what we've got going on. Right now our glitch is that we have growth in our sales tax in our economy. It's not as fast as we would hope it would be because of the ag sector. If it's just a glitch, then we should be willing to use a little bit of the reserves to get it through rather than not going back to the 3/10 we're talking about primarily for K-12. That should not be on the table in my mind. So they need to figure it out, and if they don't want to do the reserve side, then like Senator Sutton said, there is other options out there. Our stance is that the 3/10 that's required, we should not cut that back. We need to do that as a minimum for K-12.
Yeah, and I would just say that when we're talking about the reserve discussion, we need to use that money for most likely one-time expenditures. I know that, because when we talk about using reserves, they say, well, you can't use that for ongoing. Well, maybe not, but we have a lot of one-time issues to take care of in FY17 that we could use it for. And to have it not even be on the table is frustrating, because if you're an everyday citizen and you are, you know, trying to feed your family and put money on the table, or put groceries on the table for your family, and you have a small reserve account, that is used for emergency situations. If your car breaks down and you need to pay those costs because you didn't plan for that happening. Well, we didn't plan for our revenues to be giving us the problems right now that we have. We didn't plan for a lot of this. We actually had a lot higher plans for what our revenues were gonna look like. And those are the situations when you would tap in reserves, because over the last 5 years, we've put money in reserves every single year. Every year. And so to always be putting money in, but never being willing to admit that we have an emergency or a need that we could use some of those dollars to address, I think is unfair. I think it's unfair to the taxpayers because we're hoarding those dollars. We're saying we need a reserve, an emergency fund, but we're never going to touch it, ever.
Good. Any other questions? Okay.
I guess how might the Government Accountability Board mirror the Ethics Commission that voters approved in November?
If I might talk about 1076, I've been working with Karin Soley, Representative Soley, on it quite a bit, and this we've had six, seven different makeups of the board. Where this board is at right now, what it is, it's a retired Supreme Court and Circuit Court judges, and there would be four of them appointed by the governor for a five-year term. So this is a totally different makeup than any other ethics commission or board that's out there. And there was kind of an agreement across the board that, well, the nice thing is that they understand investigations. They understand when you're getting into criminal matters, because 1076, as an investigation goes, if there's a criminal matter involved, then it's referred to the DCI for investigation. And so they understand that process and how to handle it and the confidentiality involved in this discussion. So I think it's a great makeup right now. And it doesn't compare to any other board or commission or ethics commission we've got out there or what was proposed.
And I might add that when you're comparing the two, Representative Hawley is exactly right. And that's why I also contend that we do need a campaign ethics commission as well, which looks like we're not going to get. Senate Bill 53 would have been along those lines. We tried to amend 53 to be very similar to what IM-22 did, as we discussed, is to have oversight on campaign finance, because we still don't have that. Now, there is a bill moving through that allows an affidavit process, but again, that is so convoluted and difficult for the everyday citizen to work through that it isn't even close to what the intent of an ethics commission was set up to do compared to that affidavit process. And so I think that's the one big piece we're missing, is an ethics commission for campaign finance.
And you're referring to SB 151,
correct,
which came across to the House, which we have sitting on our calendar and we'll take next week. And so we'll get a little bit of discussion about that, see if we're able to broaden it, but I don't know.
And then there's also the task force on the initiative and referendum process. I guess, what are your thoughts on that, and how do you think voters might react?
You're talking about the House that they got over now, and you just passed that, you said, the 1141?
Yep.
And my concern on, first off, what that's has a legislative task force, but there's a lot of other members other than legislature involved in a task force. And I had real problems with the makeup of the task force. And then the second issue was we keep passing all these initiated measure and referendums limitations, and we're passing those now, but then we're saying we're gonna have a committee to study it this summer. So the only thing that I see happening this summer is more limitations. being put on the initiated process. If they would have been willing to say, okay, we won't do anything on initiated measures and referendums, let's go talk about it this summer and see what makes sense, I would have been a lot more open to the process. And then, you know, we've got membership on there. For example, we didn't get the extra from minority on there. So at the moment, we've got two from the majority and one from the minority from the House and Senate. We've got the South Dakota Chamber as a representative on there who's opposed initiated measures.
We got it amended.
Oh, did you get that amended? Yep. I missed that then. I better quit talking then.
No, that's all right. I'll just jump in.
We were
able to get that amended yesterday on the Senate floor, and so the House will get to have concurrence on that if they agree.
How did you change it then?
I talked to the prime sponsor, which was Representative Lust, and he was okay with the amendment. But what it did is it cut the chamber member out, gave another appointment to the governor, but what we did is required that only one of the two governor's appointments could be from the same political party. We also included a representative from the business community and the ag community have to be the governor's two appointments. Then we also put in there that the Board of Elections, the two members from there, could only be from one political party. The appointment from the Speaker of the House, from like a poli-sci professor, something of that nature, that has to be an independent or a member of a minority party. So we did ensure with that amendment that there's at least going to be a minimum of five of the what would be 13 voting members. So five of the 13 voting members are not going to be from the majority party. Did it go far enough? I don't know. But it is in a much better form than what it was, in my opinion.
Well, I feel better now. We can end on a high note, it looks like, today, huh? Is there any other questions at all? Thank you for your time. We appreciate it.
Yep, thank you.